There is one small problem though. The area for the CPU cooler on this case, it's right here. It is literally small. And that CPU is a 165 watt part, putting it at roughly 12 to 13% higher thermal output compared to our last ultimate compact build. And if you guys recall, the all copper Dynatron vapor chamber cooler that we used previously hit around 80 degrees under load. So we're gonna get to the real solution in a minute here, but first let's walk through the process. We started by breaking out the Der Bauer X299 delidding tool, popping the IHS and applying some Thermal Grizzly Conductanaut. We're gonna need every advantage we can get here, so yes, my friends, you've been begging us to do it, and here it is, a liquid metal infused 7980XE. But what to put on it? Ah, how about an NHL 12? This looks pretty good, right? Just put that on there and, oh, temps are good too. But that's outside the case and it's also nowhere even close to fitting and it can't be cut to fit. So back to the drawing board. Well, we had some success with our Dynatron cooler last time. So how about we just grab the square ILM version of what is essentially the same cooler. So you can just see it has a different screw layout. And success! Sort of. See, while we were able to get reasonable temperatures with this thing, we also had to use a Noctua 120 millimeter industrial fan in order to get them, which wouldn't be so much of a problem if we didn't also need this 92 millimeter adapter to ensure proper airflow over the CPU heatsink and around the socket. And that whole arrangement just won't fit. And our low profile fans didn't cut it. So by this point, we had completely exhausted our stock of compatible coolers before finally coming to a realization. The A4SFX V2 has a mount for a 92 millimeter radiator. So that's why this video ended up delayed. There are very few AIOs out there this size, none of which we had on hand. So after a trip to Asetek's website and another week of waiting, our 545LC arrived. This thing is not much to look at, honestly, and we weren't really expecting it to perform much better than our Dynatron cooler did. But when we fired it up for a dry run, not bad. After 2.5 hours at stock voltage under full synthetic load, our 18-core 7980XE hit a maximum of 68 degrees Celsius on any one core. Delidding, man. What a drug. On a 92 millimeter cooler. Anyway, next order of business then is to get it all together. And this is no small task. The ASRock X299E ITX AC motherboard with its 64 gigs of G-Skill RipJaws memory and Corsair NVMe SSDs in RAID 0 are easy enough, as is the GPU, but the cooler required us to remove the front USB 3 port, the lower drive tray, and the side panel clips at the front of the case in order to get it mounted properly. And to make matters worse, even with the 14 millimeter variant of the Noctua A9 fan, getting an SFX power supply in there is an absolute nightmare. With some determination though, and a healthy serving of elbow grease, we got it all in. So we just need one final check to make sure that everything is bolted in correctly and nothing's obstructed and our fan spins. Moment of truth time. Oh, damn it. Did we leave the power supply switch off?
Oh,
crap. Yes. Yep. Yay! All right, moment of truth time. Ah! I wonder what that is. No, I don't have time for this. So this is not bad. Like, it is not elegant to get the cooler in there at all. And like you could even potentially damage stuff trying to cram all of that in there. But the results, we can't really criticize. Running a CPU and GPU synthetic load, it's topping out at just over 90 degrees Celsius on the hottest core. Like, that's hot, but it's also not thermal throttling. Now let's look at some GPU-specific tests. So we've had the Unigine Superposition stress test running for almost 10 minutes now. I'm wearing my microphone here, so you can hear it's actually pretty quiet. And check this out. We're seeing turbo speeds up around 1580, 1620, 1630 megahertz. Not freaking bad. And as for the rest of the benchmarks, both synthetic and real world, this thing has absolutely chewed through them. We are really seeing the hardware not just work, but actually flex its muscle. So in the end then, the success that we saw here goes to show you just how much power you can pack into a tiny space like the A4S FX V2 without making any compromises on performance. I mean, halfway through this project, we flat out didn't expect it to work, but we're really glad that it did. This video is brought to you by the Arctic Freezer Esports 1. It's part of their Freezer series with other products including the Freezer Esports Edition with two fans and Freezer Esports TR for Threadripper. It comes in four different color variations, red, white, yellow, and green, and it's a tower CPU cooler with a push-pull fan configuration. Their new Bionics fans are optimized for very low vibration, and they have a promotion going on right now where you can pick it up for just $29.99 USD. And their MX4 thermal compound is also a great accompanying item for it. Check it out at the link in the video description. So thanks for watching, guys. If this video sucked, you know what to do. But if it was awesome, get subscribed, hit that like button, or check out the link to where to buy the stuff we featured in the video description. Also linked down there is our merch store, which has cool shirts like this one, and our community forum, which you should totally join.
Hi, my name is Jeffrey. I'm here for the J.G. Wentworth Jingle Competition.
Do I start now, or do I...
I have a structured settlement and I need...
PC system manufacturers like MSI and Gigabyte have released some fantastic small form factor gaming machines in the last couple of years. But they all have the same disadvantage. Non-standard, and in many cases, non-upgradable components. No, you have to leave it to the hardcore enthusiasts. Pioneers like Lucas...
Thank you. Cool.